and it's something that could go on in all states of the nation. And before I go, though, let me introduce a couple people in the audience. The lady who just walked in, Kathy, is also a member of Cal Pilots, and she's helping with the statewide deployment of darts there. And so in the front row, Randy Burdett is the director of the Department of Aviation for the state of Virginia. And Don is another fellow Californian with me, and we've got a couple folks as well. So welcome, thanks for coming. So who's Cal Pilots? Cal Pilots is an affiliation of 46 pilot groups in California. Generally, they're airport associations, either a pilot association at the airport or just a generic overall airport association. There's also some business affiliations, but I don't count them in 46. The mission of Cal Pilots is to promote the sense of aviation community with particular regard to preserving airports, promoting them and protecting them. I'm a member of the South County Airport Pilots Association. It's a 501c3 subchapter of Cal Pilots, and we're the originators of the DART model that Cal Pilots has taken on and is promoting. Our DART at South County Airport, DART is a disaster airlift response team, has gotten grants of $10,000 from the AOPA Foundation and $5,000 from the Northrop Grumman. Those were helpful to get just the basic rudimentary disaster equipment. So I'm Paul Marshall. I'm the DART chapter coordinator at Cal Pilots. I'm the co-chair of our DART at South County Airport. I have memberships in our County Emergency Manager Association as well as the California Emergency Services Association. And I've been flying for about 16 years or so. So first a little note, California, we had an experience during the 1989 World Series. I don't know if all of you are old enough to remember that, but a massive earthquake occurred right in the middle of the game. The ballpark started shaking, and it was 60 miles away from where the actual earthquake was. So we had a couple of coastal cities that were on the other side of the San Andreas Fault, and they got cut off. There was an airlift that got sponsored and put together about 3 days after the earthquake that delivered 750,000 tons of food, or pounds of food, to the cities of Watsonville and Santa Cruz. So let's take a moment and watch the video. It's really a nice video.
Helicopters and all other San Carlos also participated in the airlift, delivering thousands of pounds of supplies to Watsonville. In the days following the earthquake, the tarmac at Watsonville Airport was crowded with unloading aircraft. And there was so much air traffic that the FAA brought in a temporary air traffic control tower. The California Conservation Corps provided help moving the incoming supplies as five hangars were filled with goods destined for local disaster relief organizations. Over 1,000 airlift flights delivered 500,000 pounds of emergency supplies to the Second Harvest Food Bank alone. Watsonville Airport provided speedy access to the county hardest hit by the Loma Prieta earthquake. And when Watsonville needed it most, hundreds of Bay Area volunteer pilots flew in emergency supplies.
So if you have a DART team that's met once a year and they've gone through some exercises of how
put a perimeter together that would allow the public to come to us and send us people to be transported, receive goods that were received, but maintain a safe operating environment so the public isn't getting out on the ramp and getting clipped by moving planes, things like that. You can have a much safer working environment. So secondary benefits of the DART. A lot of our airports are under pressure. Developers, real estate developers, are always out there waiting to turn them into a mall. The community needs to really value the airport. A lot of communities just think it's a place where rich boys play and it's too noisy. So it makes the airport safer. Finally, we find in our exercises that pilots enjoy it, just like they enjoy flying young eagles. And the community that's out there participating in certain groups, they have a chance to get up in the airplane at a good time. So Cal Pilots is the statewide organization in California. It's decided to try to put darts throughout the state. And let's go. So why does it want to do that? So one of Cal Pilots' missions is to protect the statewide airport. I don't know if you've heard about Santa Monica. The community there has been trying to shut it down for 30 years. It's been a long struggle, but so far it's still open. And Cal Pilots is beginning to come to the conclusion, why always fight a defensive battle? Why not go out and be on the offensive and get those airports better bonded to their communities? So our model in Cal Pilots is that there's some larger issues to deal with, such as the FAA and the statewide emergency infrastructure. How do they become aware of what's going on? So Cal Pilots will deal with that, those issues that are common to all airports, and help people get started. So in the case of the South County Airport Pilot Association, it was about 4 years before it progressed far enough to even have its first exercise, and that's a terrifically slow learning curve. We hope to help other people avoid that. So what makes sense in California makes sense for the nation. We hope this will go nationwide. So if you're interested in starting a DART at your airport, how would you do it? Certainly it can be done in any state. The basic steps are you've got to have a pilot organization. Ideally, you have an existing pilot organization. The local pilots at the airport can say, you know, this makes sense. This ought to be one of our programs. So they support it. And then they've got to have somebody that stand up, raise their hand, and say, okay, I'll do it. And that could be one person, it could be a group of people. So they go out and get it started, they organize people, and they put together an annual mobilization exercise where they can practice their procedures. So then, as you do that, you reach out to your local disaster response group so that they know you're there, and they can work you into their practice exercises, and or you might work them into your practice exercise so they understand how to work with you during a real emergency. If you can put it in the newspaper, that helps the community become aware of your service, and it also helps to build that affection to the airport. And finally, your DART should just be ready to go in an emergency. Is there anyone here that's flown young eagles before? So I know that the people who put a Young Eagle program together, so it's a fairly similar set of things to worry about is to do a Young Eagle route. So there's stuff out there on the web that can help people get started and look at how it's been done before. So that's quite a mouthful, southcountypilots.org. I also have cards if anybody wants to take something home that has that website on it. But you click on that, that's the webpage for the Pilot Association. And at the left side of that webpage, there's a little, one of the many line items, it's called Scat the DART. And if you click on that, you get the whole page of everything associated with the chapter's DART. And some interesting materials there include the Disaster Airlift Response Plan. That's a document that's available in copyable format, so if anybody wanted to put them together for their own airport, they could have it. There's also some documentation of some of the different exercises that have occurred over the years. It gets an overview for starting a DART within an airport. Does anyone here have any seaplanes in their area? So this isn't a part of the South County Pilots page, but there's another directory called EVAC. And the EVAC site is worth visiting in and of itself. And on their northwest page, that's a real seaplane focused portion of the site. And it's got some excellent materials on how seaplanes have done similar things. So here's the table of contents of the disaster airlift response. got different areas of interest. Just to real briefly, it gives a high level overview in a couple pages. It gives some tips on how to mobilize and organize what the jobs are for each of the persons in the exercise, and that's about 18 pages worth. There's forms so that you can keep a record: who flew, who was flown, what was the equipment and the people that were checked in, what were the weights, what loads were put together for which aircraft, and when did they leave, and when did they come back, things like that. So it's not computer based, so you don't have to worry about computers that haven't been touched in a year still working when you try to use them. So that's the forms. There's binders. When you're in a disaster, very often the people who are going to be working, probably half of the managers, won't have ever even done it. And the other half that have done it, it's been a long time, they don't remember much at all. So you can put together a binder, which is like a go binder. The top page is a checklist of what they have to do so they understand their job. And within about an hour of briefing that, they can be ready to go and say, okay, we're going to give service and this is what I'm doing to make sure it all works. So that's the disaster village response plan. Here's an organization that puts together an exercise, and it's kind of got a dotted line. The upper half of that line is the people who kind of work on it a little bit all year long. That's your DART co-chairs or chairman. The people who just work on the day of the incident, you have function members there. There's the operations director who's in charge of everything and sets the rules for the day. So the rules can start off normally as the disaster relief response plan, but there may always be a need to deviate for some reason. So that's the guy that can make the deviation decisions. Then you have a real key job is the flight operations manager. That's the person who's organizing the pilots and giving them loads that they're going to transport. So you check and make sure that you're not exceeding the payload of any aircraft's given capacity, putting together aircraft load sheets. There's a volunteer manager who checks in all the volunteers, including the pilots. There's a ramp operations manager whose chief job is safety, keeping the public separated from moving aircraft. And their secondary job is helping pilots load and end load. There's a material manager who acts as the check-in desk, where people who want to be flown or goods that want to be flown go to that desk, they get logged in, they get weighed so they can be assigned to an aircraft to fly. There's other functions that might be staffed. There might be emergency communications if you have a ham operator, amateur radio operator that you connect to at the local emergency operations center. That could be handy if the cell phone network is down. And then below that, you have all the general volunteers. So you have pilots who report to the operations manager, a ramp crew who's supervised by the ramp manager, and a materials crew who's supervised by the materials manager. So that would be a full feature operation. And of course, any given operation is going to be a function of how big it is, how much needs to be done, and it may not have all of those functions if it's smaller. So what happens in a mobilization? Initially, at our airport, we said, if there's an earthquake, show up at the airport. Well, that's not necessarily the smart thing to do because nobody may need service. So you really want to have some communication between the founding team or the managing team and the emergency service community saying, do you guys need service? If they say yes, that's when you mobilize. Then you send stuff to your ground crew, get them out there, you see who's available to respond. That's when your management team gets assigned. And then you start recruiting people to come in and help, preferably people who are knowledgeable. When you get it going, you can communicate your in-service status to your emergency community, and then you can open up and serve the public. One final thought there is that if you need to staff it up and ramp it up to be bigger, and you've got other pilots in the area that we know or that have their own darts, you can communicate with them and bring them in for additional capacity. So flight mission parameters. These flights are done in accordance to normal Part 91 regs. That's what we're operating under. That's why they're volunteer, because this is not commercial. We're not collecting money. If you do, you'd fall under a different set of regulations. And there's a big, extensive history of volunteer organizations providing free flights. So your angel flights, your pause and pilots, and there's 40 or 50 organizations in the U.S. that provide volunteer flights under Part 91 regs. The pilots should be the insured certificate. The insurance is what forms your basic backbone insurance for the operation. As this grows, we hope to get a national insurance program that will be an umbrella over and above the pilot's insurance, much like EAA does with the Young Eagle program. There's also some state insurances that are available during real disasters that states invoke. So a key thought is that only normal flight operations are accepted. You don't want the flight manager nor the pilots accepting to do something that's not in a normal ballpark that they do every day. So responsibility, your logistics, and logistics is really a key item here. It takes a lot of organization to receive the public and figure out who's going to fly and what airplane they're going to fly in and how much. All of that is done by the DART ground crew and management. The flying is done by the pilots. So missions not flown, air ambulance is not a good mission for volunteer pilots. Almost no one has the ability to put a stretcher in on their aircraft with an FAA-approved passenger restraint. Helicopter winch rescue, there's a few helicopters scattered around in GA, but almost nobody operates with winching operations that you might get in a Coast Guard search and rescue. So specialty functions that aren't available with that pilot and that aircraft just don't bother to try to do. So safety is the first part of that. So talking more about safety. Ideally, your DART management team would be comprised and have pilots in it who are experienced, who have been around group situations at airports, and can ensure a safe operating environment. Your ramp safety, very key to have some people there that are familiar around airports, familiar about keeping the general public separated from the moving aircraft. If you have non-experienced volunteers, they should be fully oriented before they're put out on the ramp. For flight safety, there's a lot of aspects within the DART that help to ensure flight safety. The fact that you've checked the pilot's certificate and medical, that the aircraft is airworthy and insured. Pilots are signing a certification to operate in accordance with Part 91. Not that the certification is great by itself, but it's one more thing to make the pilot think that, yes, I need to operate safely and I'm going to fly according to my normal Part 91 limitations. Missions are reviewed by a flight manager and a pilot. Both of them have a responsibility to make sure that this is a safe mission. And the fact that some planning has been done with payload matching the aircraft's payload, there should be a good load put in that aircraft. There have been aircraft that have crashed in emergency transport. Really sad one in the case of the Haiti disaster, where they loaded up a plane with water, it was overloaded, and on takeoff it slid back and the guy crashed on takeoff. So weight and balance, you know, simple stuff, but it can kill people, especially in the excitement of an emergency. So here's some pictures from readiness exercises that we've done in the past at the South County Airport. This was our first one about 3 years ago. We just had a simple plastic contractor fencing barricade that we set up at the edge of the airport. The county that operated the airport gave us a key to one of the gates in the airport fence, and we set up a temporary operating area where the public could come in and request air transportation. We could fly. We have a volunteer desk where one of the pilots is signing in. We have defense assembly and that sort of thing. More recently, about a year ago, we had a mobilization exercise that occurred after we got our grants, and it was a little fancier. So we brought the community more into it, publicized it more. We worked with a local family center, the St. Joseph's Family Center. They give out food every week to families in need. And we were supplying a portion of their food for that week. So the thought being that if on a small scale exercise, we could feed the St. Joseph's Family Center, when it came time to scale it up, maybe we could feed the whole cities of Gilroy or San Martino, where we go. So we wanted each of the volunteers to bring 1 to 100 pounds of food to be donated. And of course, that food was turned around and flown in airplanes. So that was the motivating thing. Here's an airport diagram. You can see the perimeter area that we were working off of, out of one of the ramps on the field. And the public had access to the airport through that gate. So an important part of this is that all airport operations could continue on normally. We didn't disrupt the FBO. We didn't disrupt any other normal operation in the airport. The county pitched in and gave us a hangar, and we put some of our new toys in it after we got grants. We have just a couple of fancy industrial wagons. We bought some radios with antennas to communicate to the emergency centers. We have a portable shelter, basically like a two-car garage that we put on 2x12s with casters so we could roll it right out onto the field, lift it up off the casters, put a couple thousand pounds of weight on it, and boom, now we have an office building right on the ramp. Here's the radios getting set up. I mentioned there were some binders with the top page that had a checklist of what that person is supposed to do in their function, the material manager, the flight operations manager. Those are their binders that remind them what they're supposed to do. Our club president there is grabbing the plastic bag, setting something up. To his left, one of our local counties, the Monterey County Operation and Emergency Services, they were working with our amateur radio operator. Here's a couple of guys flying in from a local airport, San Jose International. Here was our ready meeting after we had set up for a couple hours. We were checking the base with each of the managers, making sure everybody was staffed properly and their function was ready to go. Here's an example of a label, so the material that comes in gets labeled so that you can see where it is on the log and how much it weighs. The passenger ticket is basically essentially the same thing, only for a passenger instead of for a box of food. That's our local captain of the Gilroy Fire Department. He's an administrative captain, handles their emergency services deal, so he came out to take a little bit over during that day. Here's the president of the Western States Alliance of Air Sheriff Squadrons. They felt that this is something of interest to them and they wanted to participate, so they brought in a couple planes. The lady seated was working with the flight operations desk. She was one of the first graduates from the Air Force Academy, so she's a nut about aviation, and this is how she was supporting us that day. Here's a graph of the operations that were flown on that day. And the inset is the longest one. That was from Bellingham, Washington, down to San Jose, California. That was an IFR operation. Of course, this is done for fun. It wasn't a real emergency, so it happened to be one of our club members who had family in that area. There's also emergency personnel in that area who were quite interested to participate in our rally, so they made a food donation, and she picked it up and brought it down. The other operations, we had one triangular operation to fly up to Sacramento and pick up one of our state aviation department people. We had another operation through the Sierra that actually got scrubbed that day because of icing. There was a spring storm going through the mountains and icing kept that pilot from launching. So the lady on the right is the one that flew the longest trip of the day, so she got her picture to commemorate it. The lady on the left is the St. Joseph's Family Center, and she was accepting a token donation of food. Of course, they had a big truck loaded up behind her. I mentioned earlier that the Seattle Seaplane folks have an interesting plan themselves of how to connect their various waterways and provide emergency service. So this is just a teaser of what Seattle's doing in emergency preparedness. This is a picture of one of their exercises that they've had in the past where they've massed float planes together and have a beach at the lake where they could transfer people that they brought in to surface transportation, helicopters and fixed wing to get them into the eastern part of the state for, say, medical attention. In the Northwest, the guy that organizes that is a nurse, so he's much more focused on medical applications. So at any rate, that's the basic presentation. I would urge you to give back to your community and start a guard at your airport. I've got some business cards up here. If anybody wants to take home my contact information, you're welcome to it. I mentioned that there's interesting pages. SouthCountyPilots.org has the SCAPA. The Cal Pilots Aviation Dart page is still under development. It's not yet in service. This is a new thing with Cal Pilots, but that's our home organization. And anybody have any further questions?